building about 20 years ago. They moved on.
Good evening, everyone. Good evening. Welcome. We're going to go ahead and get started. Thank you all for being here this evening. You're in for a real treat. My name is Brittany Cohill. I'm the Executive Director of Mandarin Museum and Historical Society, and it's my pleasure to welcome you to our third Thursday lecture for the month of May. And so first, before we get to our speaker, I just wanted to recognize some people in the room. I'm curious if we have any board members for Mandarin Museum here in the room. Any board members? Any board members here? Oh, good, good. Oh, nice. We got a lot of board members here. And how about museum members? Oh, wonderful. Wonderful. And volunteers. Wow, so I think it's all members, board members, and volunteers. That's great. I won't single anyone else out. Well, thank you all for being here. It's so wonderful to always have the support of our board, our members, our volunteers, and then all of our residents from Mandarin and across Jacksonville. I did want to thank our volunteers who are volunteering tonight at the check-in table, and then also over there at the refreshments and at our book sales. We could not do events like these without our wonderful volunteers. So, May 20th, historic buildings and store and post office are open from 10 a.m. to 2 p.m., so make sure you come and see us. Also, on the first Saturday of June, they will be open as well. And we have a frog painting party. Has anyone been to one of our frog painting parties before? A couple. It is so fun. Come and buy a world famous Mandarin frog, and they are world famous. They have gone international. And you get to purchase one, paint it right there on the front lawn of the museum, and then take it home with you. You can bring your children, grandchildren, friends. It's a whole lot of fun. You can contact us to register for that. And then Sunday, June 4th, we have our Music Under the Oaks that we host the first Sunday of every month. Who's been to Music Under the Oaks before? Oh, that is such a treat. I love riding my bike up to the museum and sitting in the shade and listening to the music. So that's 2 to 4 p.m. on June 4th. Okay, so now for the main event. Dr. Wayne Wood is here to present on Jacksonville's architectural heritage. And Wayne Wood has been regarded as one of the foremost chroniclers of Jacksonville's history and architecture. He has been referred to as, I really love this, the undisputed godfather of preservation in Jacksonville. He is an author, historian, artist, retired optometrist. He is the founder of Riverside Avondale Preservation, the Riverside Arts Market, and Friends of Hemming Plaza. And his slide presentation this evening will feature highlights from his new book, Jacksonville's Architectural Heritage. This is the Bicentennial Edition. So if you have the original edition from 1989, this is new and improved. So many more features and buildings. So you definitely want to get the Bicentennial Edition. He will also talk about stories and little known facts about some of the city's most interesting buildings. And as I mentioned, he will be available afterward to sign copies of his wonderful book. I have one already at home. So here we are, Wayne Wood.
Historical park and a museum like that is a treasure in your neighborhood. And if you didn't raise your hand as a member, I want you to sign up as a member before we go out. In fact, Tracy, can we lock the doors and check? It's indeed a pleasure to be here, and I thank you for coming out tonight. This is what I do for fun. So let's get started. You know, American cities are all becoming the same. Cleveland looks like Birmingham. Pittsburgh looks like Houston. Commercial clutter has beaten much of the character out of our cities and towns. Downtowns are choked with bland boxes that have no souls. Many of our most popular buildings are duplicated in every city in America. Crap. Excuse me. They have exact duplicates all across America. And it wasn't always this way. Good architecture was once the expected norm throughout our culture. A century ago, American architecture was at its zenith, and the craftsmanship of a building denoted the character and quality of its owner. And they were beautiful, and they spoke to people as they go by and say, "Come inside, this is a good place." Those buildings gave distinction and personality to towns and neighborhoods across America. And most houses used to have porches, and neighborhoods used to have sidewalks. And before air conditioning encapsulated us in our automobiles and TV rooms, and before computers and our cell phones became our very best friends, people used to actually sit on porches and walk on sidewalks, and people actually communicated to their friends. It was built into the architecture. I love this series of porches where you, this is on Osceola Street in Riverside, you could stand on one porch at the end of the block and see the neighbors sitting on the porch at the other end of the block. I miss that. Many of Jacksonville's wonderful buildings from a century ago have unfortunately been torn down in the last 50 years. The vast majority of downtown buildings that were built after the Great Fire over 100 years ago, they're all gone. And these buildings gave our city character, and we've forfeited much of that because of their loss. In the early 1900s, Riverside Avenue was lined with beautiful mansions. There were 50 of these great houses. It was known as one of the most beautiful streets in America. And one by one, these great mansions have been torn down. There are only two of them left out of the original 50 mansions. This was my grandparents' house on Riverside Avenue. And just as an aside, they weren't rich. When I was a little kid, my brother and I would try to reach around those big columns and touch each other. We couldn't, they were so big. So I always thought my grandparents were the wealthiest people on earth. They had 35 people to dinner some nights. Of course, it was a boarding house. They bought it for $9,000 in the midst of the Depression. I don't think it ever got painted in the 40 years they owned it. But I have wonderful nostalgic memories of a child crawling around on the third floor up there in the attic and looking at old deer heads and World War I helmets and things like that that are a part of me, even though that building is gone. But these beautiful homes were the pride of the city, and they're gone now. In 1977, I was elected chairman of the Jacksonville Historical Landmarks Commission, and we realized that Jacksonville had all these nice buildings, but there was really no history, no research done on who the architects were and so forth. So we decided to write a pamphlet. And the more we researched and the more we dug, the more we realized there is a lot here that people don't know. So we decided instead of a pamphlet to do a book. And I kept telling people it would be out for Christmas. I just didn't tell them which year. 12 years later, in 1989, the first edition of Jacksonville Architectural Heritage was published by the City of Jacksonville. Since that book was published, over 20% of the buildings in that original book are gone. 20%. Over almost 100 buildings that were our cherished landmarks are gone. Like the old Art Deco post office designed by Clutho on Bay Street, or the women's club that was devoured by Formosan termites, or many, many old beautiful houses in Riverside and Springfield have been demolished for commercial entities. Our great locomotive over at the convention center was given away by our mayor, our previous mayor, fortunately. I'll never forgive him for that. There's no reason to trash our landmarks that we own as a city. And there are so many buildings in Mandarin since that building was written up. I think there's probably a dozen, including this, the Fleming Bowden House, that are gone, devoured by developers. Beautiful prairie-style funeral home in downtown Jacksonville was burned in a big fire about 3 years ago. It was a lovely building. So, over the years, I've resisted the many requests to write a new edition of Jacksonville's architectural heritage with all the buildings gone. As my wife, Lana, is an artist, and like her, once you've done a painting or a sculpture, you don't want to do the same one all over again. So I fought hard not to do another edition of it. But then some things happened. The last book I did was called Life, The Untold Story of Charles Adrian Pillars, which I think is probably the best book I've ever done. There's a copy of it over there if any of you are interested. He's the sculptor who did the Memorial Park statue. And his life was just amazing. And it's the full biography from his childhood until he died in poverty and achieved great worldwide fame and then became homeless. It's an amazing story. So I was doing a book signing for that at San Marco Bookstore. And after I got through, I walked back in the store, and back in the back, there was a column, a little white ionic column with a copy of Jacksonville's architectural heritage, the original version of it, on that little pedestal. And there was a sign on it, $250. My gosh, this is not right. You know, the book cost $30 when we published it back in 89. And so I started thinking about it. Maybe there's a demand for this that I'm not thinking about. And then the idea came about that last year was the 200th anniversary of Jacksonville, the Bicentennial. And there were no monuments, there were no statues, there was nothing done to commemorate our Bicentennial. So I said, maybe a book would be a good way to commemorate Jacksonville's 200th anniversary. So I got thinking, and finally I gave in and got around with help. One of people like Sandy and Tracy Arpin and many others who updated the research. We added 400 new buildings to the book. And the biggest part was we re-photographed every building. Originally, the book was in black and white. This book is in color, with great architects like my friend Mark Kranzer and Olus Garber. Olus took a wonderful panorama portfolio of all the buildings in Mandarin. Many of you heard him in his talk a few months ago. And so we're enriched by having all these great new photographs of buildings that were not possible to photograph as we did before, because Mark has a drone. Some buildings you just can't see anymore. They have trees, they have signs. Yeah. And with a drone, you can get, this is a picture from the original book of a house in Riverside. And here's the way it looks today from the perfect angle from a drone in color. And color is wonderful. Here's a picture of the old brown house here in Mandarin from the original book. And here's the portrait that Olus took in living color. Beautifully, the perfect perspective, perfect color. So this book makes the old book totally obsolete. So if you have one of the old ones, chunk it in the garbage. Make sure before you do, you get a copy of the new one. Here's a picture of a mansion in Avondale, and just how much better it looks in color compared to the original book. And then there are buildings like this that you cannot see this angle and appreciate the majesty of its geometry, designed by architect Ted Pappas. It's the Mary Singleton Senior Center in Springfield. Many of you have driven by it and never would have noticed it in 100 years. Isn't that, that's just classic. Or who knows what this building is? Oh, that's no fair. It's the chart house. Did you realize this magnificent building has this much incredible forms to it? It was designed by a world-famous architect, Kendrick Bangs Kellogg, And it is truly one of the great, great buildings in Jacksonville.
And we still have it.
And we still have it. Now, the original book, like the chart house wasn't in the original book. It was built. But the fact is, it wasn't 50 years old. The buildings in the original book had the criteria that it had to be 50 years old, which makes it eligible for the National Register. That was our cutoff point. So many buildings, like these modern buildings, this is St. Paul by the Sea out of Jacksonville Beach, were incredible. In fact, many people didn't even know it existed because it's kind of hidden away. But it was not eligible, and it's in this book. And the buildings built after World War II by young architects who came out, who were excited about the prospects of building in creative concrete and making buildings that could have shapes no previous architects could build because the technology wasn't there. So we have this wonderful set of mid-century modern building. Here you see it from Mark's drone. Just an amazing sculptural organic shape. And buildings like Bob Brower's Unitarian Church, one of my favorite buildings in Jacksonville. And these are three buildings by William Morgan, another mid-century modern architect who's known throughout the world. The thing that's so cool about these is all three of these buildings are a different style. Morgan worked over a period of almost 40 years, and he went through a lot of different phases of development: earth houses, tree houses, fortresses like Inca ruins and things. And so there's one stretch in Atlantic Beach that's three blocks long that has 10 of his buildings. I call this Morgan's Row because it has 10 of the greatest mid-century modern buildings in the Southeast within three blocks. It's almost a rarity in America that one architect who has this great a career would have so many different specimens of his work in a narrow area. And these are all Morgan buildings. Every one of them is totally different, represents a different style from his work. And they're all there. There are other buildings that are over 50 years old now that are not mid-century modern, but like our church next door are just wonderful examples of architecture. This was built in the 60s to replace the 1880s building that was destroyed by the hurricane. And it's a wonderful building in its own right, done by Drake and Petillo, two of our great mid-century modern architects, although this is definitely not mid-century style. Another thing we left out of the original book was a lot of African-American sites. You know, a lot of them were not 50 years old, and so they didn't qualify, but a lot of them are not sophisticated, classical, scholarly architecture, but they're wonderful, like this African church on Myrtle Avenue. It's just beautiful, and it represents the culture of the community that built it. Many members of the congregation, as well as the architect who was in the congregation, built this building. And there are treasures, and they've been overlooked, and the book celebrates, and there are over 80 African-American cultural sites in the new book that were left out of the old one. There's another church down the street on Myrtle Avenue. Just beautiful. And then Edward Waters College has a number of architecturally significant buildings that are worthy of being noticed. Many of us white folks don't know about Sugar Hill. Sugar Hill was where the aristocratic middle-class professionals in the African-American community lived, just to the west of I-95. I-95 was built through the middle of Sugar Hill and totally wiped it out. Partly before consolidation, African-Americans were approaching the majority of the population of Jacksonville, and this was one way of isolating their communities from downtown. It's a tragedy. We lost hundreds and hundreds of great buildings from the architecture of the African-American community. But one of the greatest ones, fortunately, is still left, that of Bishop Tooks. This is on 8th Street. What the interstate didn't wipe out, the hospital complex took out the rest of them. So there are still a handful of these buildings from Sugar Hill and Black Jacksonville. Now, here's another African-American-related building. You might drive by this 100 times and never even look at it until you realize this was the home of Zora Neale Hurston, the great American author, lived in that house for many years. And then there are buildings like this that don't look too striking architecturally, but this was originally a vaudeville house on Ashley Street, which was the heart of the African-American Renaissance in Jacksonville. Jazz clubs all up and down the street, and it's now, it was the Bijou Theater, and now it is Clara White Mission. And here's one of those stories that just sort of we lucked on doing our research and finding out about it. Perhaps the most famous architect in the United States in the 1950s, other than Frank Lloyd Wright, was Paul Revere Williams. He was an African-American architect in Hollywood. He designed the LAX airport, you know, the space flying saucer looking building. He designed houses for all the Hollywood stars, Frank Sinatra, Lucille Ball, Bela Lugosi. And he built a house in Jacksonville that we didn't know about. The story is that this woman named Ms. Nixon, her husband had the temerity to vote in an election up in Georgia near Macon. And the white sheriff told him not to vote. He voted anyway. And that evening, he was shot on his front porch in front of his children. And the men who shot him confessed. They said it was self-defense. And they got off the hook. And although Ms. Nixon testified courageously against him, but after the trial, her life was in danger. So she fled to Jacksonville to live with some relatives in a two-bedroom house. They had nine people, including her five children. And so this was taken up by a newspaper up in Pittsburgh, the Pittsburgh Courier, and they did a series of stories about it to raise money to get Christmas presents. Paul Revere Williams read about that and said, I'll design a house for her. If you get the lot, I'll design the house. And so there's a wonderful little bungalow over near Edward Waters College designed by the most famous architect and the greatest African-American architect of all times. So, architecture, you know. I thought a lot about architecture. I'm not an architect, didn't get any training in architecture. But when you think about it, it's the most public of all the arts. You know, the buildings are out there for all of us to enjoy. We drive by them every day and we share them as a community. They're not hidden in a museum or a gallery. They're part of us. They're part of our neighborhood. They're part of our culture. And we all own some part of this building, even though it's not necessarily ours. When we have these buildings and share them, they enrich us. When buildings are beautiful, they uplift our community. And they visually connect us. And they're works of public art, truly. And they help give us a sense of place and a higher meaning to our city. They're what make us different from all the other cities, the old humdrum towns around America. These are our unique heritage and our legacy that make us who we are and make us different from all those other bland places. You can say wow anytime you want to. If you see a building you've never seen before. Surprisingly and ironically, architecture is the most fragile of all the arts. Buildings made of stone and steel and reinforced concrete and cemented into the ground are far more likely to be destroyed and not to last as a poem or a play or a book or a symphony. They will long outlive our most beautiful buildings in Jacksonville. And because they're fragile, we need to help them all the more. This is a building over on University Boulevard in Arlington. Do you know this building? This is a bank, a mid-century modern bank built in the 60s by a very prominent Miami architect, Edwin T. Reeder. And this building, which was a bank, is on the chopping block to be torn down to make a car wash.
Oh.
What a unique building. There's nothing else in Jacksonville like this. It is truly a work of art that...
We don't need another car wash.
We need another historic building. And so this has been the attitude. I've been doing this since the early 70s, and my heart breaks every time we lose a building that has value, that is part of our community, and it's just a shame to lose it. We need to have more foresight. Now, this is a great building. This is a Ford Motor Assembly Plant built in the 1920s, designed by Alfred Kahn. Now, Alfred Kahn was one of the great architects in the world at the time. He designed 1,000 buildings for Henry Ford. He designed mass production buildings to build mass production cars. He helped Henry Ford invent mass production. And this wonderful building is world famous. And it's the owner of it who bought it about 10 years ago, who knew it was world famous, and yet he's gonna tear it down probably next week. This is our Picasso. And we're letting it be ripped apart. The city council voted to let him tear it down. The JA building, another wonderful mid-century modern building that doesn't get a lot of credit, but I think it's really cool. There's nothing else like it. It's designed by some very prominent New York architects. JEA is moving out of the building, and the word is the building is going to be torn down. Why tear it down? Save this building. The University of Florida is about to set up a new university downtown. They're going to take up probably 10 square blocks, including half of FSCJ's parking lot and part of the fairgrounds and 7 historic buildings to build their campus if our current mayor has his way. You could do the entire campus that already has parking and built in this building on, what is it, 18 stories. And so you have all the departments. It's a perfect building to build a university. And it would cost money to fix it up, but far less than wasting all that land and all the money that would be spent on new buildings. This needs to be a cause, and you better believe that our new mayor is hearing about this right now. And so there are other buildings that we've already lost that are too late to bring them back. But this is torn down. I remember this when I was in the 70s. Mm-hmm. This was the Harbor Master's house over near Friendship Park, designed by Taylor Hardwick. What a cool building. Mm-hmm. Or this is a world famous building designed by a guy named Bruce Goff, who was a Frank Lloyd Wright apprentice. Yeah. This was over on the old San Jose Boulevard. It was torn down by one of Jacksonville's well-known families. I won't mention their name because then I might say something bad. And here's another church designed by Bob Broward, needlessly destroyed. Now, it's a matter of perspective. This is an interesting, odd building designed by William Morgan, a beach house. We cannot necessarily trust our aesthetic preferences in this 2023 time, looking at this house. It may not appeal to us, but we can't really judge what will be wonderful in the future. And so many of these buildings that don't really fit our expectations, we need to give a second chance, especially when it was designed by a famous architect. This building is torn down. A good example of that is the old city hall designed by Clutho a couple of years after the Great Fire. This was the pride of the city that had been wiped out by fire, with its copper dome and its classical columns. This was a building for all times. 50 years later, those old buildings are out of style, out of fashion. It wasn't big enough really to hold the city hall anymore. So they tore it down and built the Hayden Burns Library. A quirky, wonderful, strange building by Taylor Hardwick. And this was ultra modern at the time. It was the pride of the city. This was the coolest building in town when it was built. 50 years later, it was ugly. It wasn't big enough for a library anymore. So there was a big move afoot to tear it down. Thankfully they didn't. Yeah. Yes. This mid-century modern masterpiece is one of the great buildings of Jacksonville. I predict 100 years from now, when architectural historians come to visit Jacksonville, they will come to see 4 buildings. St. James Building by Clutho, mm-hmm. The Gulf Life Tower, which is internationally renowned as one of the great skyscrapers in America, the Chart House, and the Hayden Burns Library. Luckily, it was saved, and it is going to be part of our architectural heritage for a long time. But far too often, the whims of fashion and greed and inept maintenance cause these great buildings to go away. And this kind of summarizes my philosophy. I don't want to seem like I'm preaching too much here. I'm going to anyway.
You're at a church.
I can put on my best Episcopalian priest. No. So I drive by this building several times a week. It's a house on St. John's Avenue. I don't own this house. I don't own this door. But if the owner of this house destroyed that house, if he closed in the door, or even worse, tore it down, I would have a great personal loss. Not because I have any ownership in it, but I do have a right to the legacy of this building being there as part of my culture and my heritage. And we have to realize that many, many people before this owner owned it. Many owners after this owner will own it again, on into the future generations and maybe even centuries. We're stewards of this. Even though we don't own it, we owe the right to this beautiful building, this work of art, to do all we can to preserve it. We can't preserve every old building. Every old building should not be saved. But buildings that reflect our history, our culture, that are aesthetically wonderful and beautiful, we need to fight with all of our might to preserve those for future generations. And this one is one of those. Just a little small doorway, but it's precious. When I look at Jacksonville from the sky, from a satellite view, I'm reminded of Bob Brower. Many of y'all knew Bob. He lived out in Switzerland for a long time. He was one of Jacksonville's great architects, apprentice of Frank Lloyd Wright. And he and I were really good friends. And one time he told me that Jacksonville, that little red dot, is located in one of the greatest places in the entire world to build a city. Maybe second to Paris, France. Think about it, we have the climate, we have all the wonderful trees, the estuaries, the river, the ocean, the wildlife, and we've so far not been ruined like so much of South Florida has been overdeveloped. And so his theory was that Jacksonville could and should be one of the great cities in the world. Not the biggest, but one of the greatest as far as quality of life and enjoyment of the place where we live. And yet, we've squandered it. All the city leaders for the last, well, since almost 100 years, have not stepped up to lead Jacksonville to be what it could be. Their interest has been more in encouraging development at the price of our heritage, rather than building a city that has primary emphasis on its aesthetic qualities. And as long as those financial considerations are put above our quality of life, we have a lot more to lose. We really, really do. You know, Jacksonville has been running on the cheap for the last 50 years. We have the lowest tax rate of any large city in Florida, and yet we haven't raised our taxes. We haven't done anything to try to enrich this city since maybe Mayor Austin's River City Renaissance devoted money to building quality things, but that was short-lived and very narrowly focused. We need to have our whole city be led by leaders who want to take us to a level that will make us what we could be and what we should be and what we deserve to be. Our development standards and our building guidelines are very, very often bent or ignored. Every time a developer applies for a zoning that overrides the previous protections, 90% of the time they're permitted. I'm not anti-developer. We need more developers. We need more enlightened developers who will lead our city instead of building claptrap stuff like this. An ugly building is a scar that we all must endure.
No.
The largest building built with city money in the last decades is the Duval County Courthouse. This is one of the ugliest buildings ever constructed in Jacksonville. It has no purpose. It is trying to be a historic building. It's trying to mimic some sort of classical grand cathedral or temple. You can't build a historic building. In fact, this is all wrong. The columns are the wrong height, wrong proportion. The little portico on the front is not even touching the main building. It's so wrong. And yet, if you spend my taxpayer money to build a new building, make it grand, make it wonderful, make it reflect who we are in Jacksonville, not just now, but what we aspire to be, instead of building junk. Now, having said that, if you look at downtown Jacksonville today, look at all this vacant land on the riverfront. Opportunity for us to build something wonderful. Just for perspective, the star is where the Jacksonville landing site is. Just a big field of grass today. Something wonderful is going to go in there. They've said, but we follow through. So many times we've had grand ideas and schemes and let them go by the wayside. We run Jacksonville on the cheap. Now, what goes there is going to speak to generations in the future. And it doesn't have to be the Sydney Opera House. And it doesn't have to be the great arts building in Valencia, Spain. And it doesn't need to be the Milwaukee Art Museum. But on the other hand, why the hell not? We deserve something wonderful. Now, I'm all about historic architecture, but if you think about it, the buildings that are revered 100 years from now are being built today. And we're building five-story apartment buildings made out of 2x4s that are just ugly and insane. We need and deserve world-class buildings. Now, I will say that Jacksonville has a wonderful portfolio of buildings. We're sandwiched between St. Augustine and Savannah, you know, two cities that tout their historic architecture. Jacksonville has more significant architectural sites, historic, architecturally, nationally important, than any other city in Florida. I promise you that's true. In fact, I'm going to prove it to you. Fasten your seatbelts.
Thank you. Escaped the Jacksonville fire, and it was originally Wynn's Hotel. And during the jazz era in the 1920s and 30s, when Ashley and Jefferson Street were the hub of the Harlem Renaissance of the South, Louis Armstrong, Cab Calloway, Ray Charles, all those great performers were there. Louis Armstrong liked to stay in that hotel because he could come out on the balcony and wave to his followers down the street. That building is hanging on by a thread, but I've seen buildings in worse shape than that that made it. So my fingers are crossed. The city owns it. If our city doesn't do something about it, it's their fault. So this is one of those cases where...
But it's not targeted at present.
There are no current plans. It's just mothballed right now. It has a temporary roof on it. And if you look in the book, it's in the La Villa section. It has a picture of how it originally looked at a mansard roof. It's a gorgeous building and could be put back that way again. But thank you for that question. Yes?
The Swisher Estate, did I miss seeing that in San Marco? The old Swisher Estate? Boyer's
I only showed you 500 pictures here tonight. And I have probably 2,000 more, not all of which made it in the book.
Okay.
The fact that the Swisher Mansions, two wealthy mansions built in the 20s by our most prominent architect, Marsh and Saxelby, for the tobacco family, the Swishers. The fact that I didn't even need to include those two fabulous mansions in my slideshow, that's kind of a message. I hope you realize. If you start thinking of buildings I didn't show you, that are your favorite buildings, just goes to show you how much we have here. Because Jacksonville is so spread out, and we don't see all these buildings in close proximity to each other, unless you're in the Springfield Historic District or Riverside Avondale in San Marco and places where they're close, you don't realize what a treasure Jacksonville architecture really is. Yes.
Thank you for all you've done for our community. I mean, you've had a great legacy for the city. So one of the things I know, you were very active, I recall, in getting Riverside and Avondale to be a historic district. So in Mandarin, we have a lot of history here along Mandarin Road, constantly under threat. We have, right now, even a rezoning at County Dock and Loretta Road, where they want to build high-density tract houses. And so to protect the character of the neighborhood and create context for these buildings, can you help us out here in Mandarin?
Well, I'll give you just some ideas. San Marco is a good text
bookcase. For 30 years, I've been trying to get San Marcos to become a local historic district. And they've refused because property rights, I'm not going to have any government tell me what to do with my property. Mm-hmm. I pronounce that right. Riverside and Avondale, back in the 70s when I first moved there, were dying. I mean, many of you are old enough to remember that it was quickly becoming a slum and people were moving out. Beautiful houses were being divided up into two and three plexes. And it was not a desirable place. And so that's why we started Riverside Avondale Preservation. Our first goal was to become a historic district, because not only a national historic district, but even more important, a local historic district, because that gives you protections. We have a very weak preservation ordinance compared to Savannah and St. Augustine, but at least if somebody wants to come and do something stupid to one of these great buildings, there is a pathway they have to go through to get there, and oftentimes that gives enough time to explain what their plans are wrong and how to steer them in the right direction. So San Marcos just refused that. I've given them sermons many, many times. And over the last 10 years, they've lost 30 historic homes. In many cases, they tore down two houses and built a mansion in their place. But the architecture of what they were replaced with was not worthy of what they tore down. There is a neat thing on the National Register of Historic Places called a thematic group. I haven't heard this done in a long time, but I think it could be done. Normally, the National Register Historic District, the buildings have to be contiguous. And although if you took out all the modern development, the Mandarin buildings are contiguous. They just, you know, the houses were half a mile apart. There were farms in between.
Right.
And if you squint, and sometimes I can actually do this, sometimes I can squint and actually see old Mandarin still there. But so much infill has happened and so many great buildings have gone that you could do a thematic group where the buildings don't have to be contiguous, but they're in proximity and they all have a relationship. And so they could be a National Register Historic District. And I believe you could probably get a local historic district. Instead of having to nominate each individual house to be a landmark by itself, you could just do the whole neighborhood. It takes, I hope you'll do that. Clap. Clap is a good idea. There are consultants you can get. You can hire and pay them $1,000, and they will do that for you. And so that's one idea. I hope you'll follow up on that. And the other thing is just having a strong neighborhood organization. When we started RAP, we didn't have anything except a bunch of old falling down buildings and an idea. What we had to sell was history, architecture, and scenery. And so unlike other neighborhoods that are being built at that same time in the 70s, Deerwood, Bay Meadows, they had multi-million dollar advertising campaigns. So we decided to be a small advertising agency for an old neighborhood. And your Mandarin Historical Society and Museum is that. And you need to do all you can to support them. And think big out of the box, because the people who want to do the opposite of what you want are very powerful, very rich, very entrenched, and have good lobbyists and lawyers. Yeah. And you don't. You're just little people who love where you live. You're not little people. You're wonderful, big, big people, bold people who can conquer giants. And you've done it. I mean, if you just look at how much has been saved and how the buildings looked 35 years ago when we did Jacksonville Architectural Heritage, many of them are falling down. That are now beautifully restored and hopefully will be passed on to future generations to keep restoring them. But you have to get the community believing in its own value. I think that's the most important part. And you've done that, but you've got to pass it on to younger people. Look
and
around the room.
One of the young persons with a hand up over there.
Yeah, and the only young person in the room. I'm sorry. No, but we have to pass it on. All you young people. Let's give the young people applause. They're going to sing their bacon. And that's what we convince them. It's like churches. Churches, in many cases, are dying because the young people aren't being brought in. So preservation is like a religion. We need to evangelize for our young folks. And so you're a young folk, and you have a question I'd like to try to answer.
I do. So out of all of the historic places in Mandarin, what is your favorite and why?
The question is, out of all the historic buildings in Mandarin, it's got to be the King House, which is just a great example of Victorian architecture. It's well preserved. It's a beautiful house, and I can't tell you where it is, but it's in Mandarin. And you can see that Olus took a fabulous picture of this building. It's in the book. It's one of the most beautiful photographs in the entire book of that house. That is so much part of Mandarin story. You know, the heyday of Mandarin was back in after the Civil War, when Harry Beecher Stowe was here, and all these Northern and European farmers came in here with the idea that they could enjoy Florida living, at least in the wintertime, and grow oranges. They didn't know anything about growing oranges, but they made a go of it. And so that is the nugget of Mandarin's great history. And so that building, I think, embodies that more than any. If Harriet Beecher Stowe's house was still here, I would pick that one. But next to that is the campus. Thank you for that question. Let's do one more. So far, no trick questions. Okay, well, that's good. Thank you all so much for coming out tonight. It's a pleasure.
Thank you, Wayne. That was so wonderful. I really enjoyed the video montage, too. That was unexpected, but I really love that. As I said, he will be over here at the table signing his books if you would like to purchase one. Thank you again for being here. We have our next Third Thursday lecture in August. We will be back at the Community Club for that one. And I should have thanked Church of Our Savior at the very beginning for giving us a home this evening. The Community Club was inadvertently double booked, and so we said, no problem, we will find another venue. So here we are. So thank you to Church of Our Savior. And and if you don't follow us already on Facebook, or if you don't get our emails yet, go ahead and sign up on our sign up list to get our emails and stay updated on future events like these. But one more round of applause for Wayne Wood. Thank you all for coming, and we'll see you next time.